So we have a pretty packed schedule for the next 2 days. And without further delay, I'd like to hand over the stage to Dr. Anita. She, as all of you have read, she heads an organization called PUKAR. They're based in Bombay. They do a lot of community training and also do pretty in-depth documentation about stories with members within the communities. And there's a lot of parallels between how PUKAR does their work and how OpenStreetMap makes the map. So I'm excited to hear what she has to say. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It gives me a real pleasure and honor to be talking to such an august audience. And I truly want to convey my heartfelt thanks to Arun for inviting me. Me and Arun met a couple of years ago at a separate conference where I heard him talking about mapping. And I still remember he said how empowered he felt when he drew a map of bus map of Hyderabad at night. That is something that stayed with me, Arun. And I always felt that a very highly educated, highly skilled person, if he can feel so empowered with something like mapping, how would it work for people who are totally uneducated, illiterate, and living on the fringes of society? So that's what I'm going to be sharing with you. It really gives me an added pleasure because most of you are either familiar with or associated with open street mapping, mapillary, IDFC institutes, you know, institutes which actually have created the possibility of democratizing the knowledge, democratizing the creator of the knowledge, and the ownership of the knowledge. It's phenomenal that anybody sitting in a Timbuktu can actually contribute to open street mapping and help others. That is exactly what PUKAR's basic fundamental ethos is, that we believe in democratizing the knowledge which is created at every level of community. And we have challenged and changed the ownership of that knowledge by doing community-based participatory research. So therefore, it's a real privilege for me to be here. I was also very impressed with what Professor Oja talked about, the interpretation of their logo, that it is about not just creating knowledge, but sharing knowledge. So on that note, let me go back to what I actually need to stay here. But before I go, I was thinking about what Professor Hema said, and one of the most negative part of mapping, which many of you may not even know, because many of you were, most of you were probably born after the partition of this country. One line was mapped between a continent, and two countries were created overnight. And to me, that has been the most negative part of mapping. And I'm sure such maps were created all across the world by people who were in power. So we need to get over that and make it democratized. So I hope I'm going to be able to deal with. So a bit about PUKAR. So PUKAR is an independent research collective, an urban knowledge producing center that provides platform for community-based participatory action research. And we use CBPAR as a tool for youth development and community development. We have used it very successfully over the last 14 years. Our vision is basically to produce a world-class incubator for producing knowledge, ideas, and innovations that foster inclusive and sustainable communities and cities. And we do it mostly through lens of youth, and our definition of youth is pretty much what the country's definition of youth is, which is from 80 to 30. This is my city with Dharavi on foreground. And this is the map of the lifeline of our city. And I'm sure most of you have done a lot of mapping with infrastructures. So I'm going to take you through some of the interesting slides because, you know, a lot of you do probably mapping of infrastructures, health, but some of the social trends also can be very easily mapped. So this is a map of slums of Mumbai. This is actually older, old time from old census. And if you look at these areas, this is where most of the slums are, which are not included in the map. Now, if you look at this particular area, especially M East Ward, where we have done a lot of work, here it shows that it has about 31% population in slums. Actually, today in M East Ward, it's 82%. And majority of those people come are migrants. Now, look at this area. This is where, this is old city where old money is. And now, look at the sex ratio. And look at the sex ratio here. That is the lowest. It is much higher in the slums and lowest where the money is. Now, you can draw your own conclusions. Some of these, a few maps I'm going to run through very fast. So this is dispensaries or health mapping of Mumbai city through corporation. Majority of dispensaries are located in the city and not in the suburban city. This is analysis of unfit water samples, and they are pretty bad everywhere. Crime report against women from 2011 to 2014, and you can see they have gone up just about everywhere. This is governance, fire stations, and you can see that majority of them are located in the city. M East Ward, which is the largest ward in the corporation, has only two fire stations because majority of the people live in the slums, so they don't care whether you live or die through your fire. And this is, of course, the tree cover. I'm sure you know Mumbai has the lowest tree cover among all the metros of the world. And of course, this is our famous flooding situation. It floods everywhere. So this particular thing comes from Urban Design Research Institute. They're close to 250 maps on this website, and they become very helpful for people, students, researchers, and everybody. Okay, I'm going to come back to this particular map, which is the map of slum population. So you'll ask me, why are you back here? So what does it mean for people to be living in a slum? This is what it means. That means you don't have any formal legal address or identity. If you have no address, you have no Aadhaar card. If you have no Aadhaar card, you have no ration card, you have no voting right, you have nothing. You don't exist. It also means not to be counted in any of the city surveys. Like I showed you earlier on the city survey, all those slums were excluded. It means deprivation of service delivery. No water, no electricity, no tenure, no sewage disposal. Health and education is further away. It means no one can protect you if somebody wants to come and bulldoze your house. There's nothing. Nobody's going to stand behind you. It also means receiving no emergency aid in crisis situations. And I'm sure some of you have mapped localities and helped during the crisis situations, whether they were floods, there were fires. But we have experienced in Kaulabandar, where we worked for 5 long years. We had fire in 2010. Kaulabandar is located 20 minutes from the financial nerve center of our country. 20 minutes, 60-year-old slum. It took them 3 hours for the fire engines to arrive because, you know what the driver told us? Tum map pe nahi ho. That was his answer, and which was true. That slum doesn't exist on the map of the BMC. It also means being called a law-breaking migrant who does not pay taxes. Hence, he should return to his village. It means not to have any right to your own city. So how do we change that situation for people? What should people in these communities should do? One of the solutions for changing this is community mapping. when people from the community themselves go out and start mapping their communities, they look at the resources and assets they have. They also look at what the needs are and what they are lacking. It also builds a cohesiveness between the community members because they all are looking at it from the same perspective. It also helps them sort of to build some equation with the local authorities, maybe the local cooperator, the MLA, the MP, and it also sort of helps them to relate to the larger city. So I think this is what helps them. It empowers the community by democratizing the knowledge and the community. It helps to build their resilience. See, like I always go back to that Arun's saying that he said, I feel so empowered once I looked at those maps. That empowerment, that sense of empowerment also creates a resilience in you to be able to overcome a difficult situation. It builds cohesiveness. It helps to create strong community leadership. I have seen that in most of my colleagues. Most of my colleagues actually live in slums. We have been working with them for last 8 to 10 years. They all are now trained. And wherever they are, whether they are in Kolabandar, whether they are in Mandala East, the local community goes to them for various of their questions because they say, oh, Bali knows answer to this, or Kajal will find out what this is all about. It helps to build community networks with outside agencies, and also it provides a fabulously granular data for researchers and scholars. See, if I'm living in the community and I see Nizam, who is my next door neighbor, coming to ask me for some information, I know that Nizam faces the same troubles and same problems living where I am. We both share the same situation. It's easy for me to share my information with Nizam as opposed to sharing with that Dr. Anita who paratroops on the community maybe once a month. It is as simple as that. So we actually get the kind of information we have received over the last 14 years from various different communities is absolutely amazing. And that's one of the reasons we have been able to do many, many collaborative projects with very renowned premier international institutions like Harvard, Columbia, UFC, Berkeley. We have worked with many national and international universities. So once the process that I just described, Professor Arjun Upadhyay, who is the world-renowned cultural anthropologist and founder of PUKAR, he calls this process deep democracy. It's a method or process of organization, mobilization, teaching, and learning that builds on what the poor know and understand. So we have taken this Professor Arjun Upadhyay's work, and he's a very seminal essay called Right to Research, which he published in 2006. We have taken that idea that everybody has a right to research, and we have created a module called Youth Fellowship Program where we have created an entire training course which teaches the local community members how to do participatory action research in their community. And we have close to about 150 current barefoot researchers spread across the city, and we have trained close to 4,000 people, 4,000 youth over the last 14 years. This program is running, this year is the 14th year, and it has also been accredited by Tata Institute of Social Sciences. So I just wanted to reiterate the fact that community mapping is very well known, documented as an instrument for community empowerment. And I think there are many, many research papers that you will find if you go out on the internet. What it does is actually gives the knowledge production and knowledge ownership in the hands of community. And the minute community people can get to the authorities with some evidence and some data, they have better negotiating power. Almost all slums or informal settlements have certain amount of legality or illegality. but they also form one of the finest workforce in every metro, not just in India, but everywhere else. And I'm sure you all have, those of you who come from metros have experienced it. It's from your driver to your domestic worker to everybody else who runs the city. They also put in a huge amount of money into the city's coffers. So I don't know if you are aware, Dharavi, which is, most of you know Dharavi, it's a slum. It's actually not a slum. It's an informal city within a formal city. And Dharavi puts more than 1 billion rupees every year in Bombay Municipal Corporation's coffers, making Mumbai the richest local body in India. But they still are not looked up as a legal settlement. Everybody still thinks of Dharavi as slum. And I'm waiting for that one day when every single person in the city of Mumbai who lives in the slums will go on strike and will not go to work. And I will be delighted to see that city coming to a total standstill. And that will happen in every single metro in this country. I'm going to run through some of the Dharavi mapping that we did in 2010 under Ford Foundation. So this is selected communities of Dharavi as they are scattered. These are the dominant castes. And if you read those castes, it is Dhor, Potters, Kunbi, Chankas, Buddhists. All of these are either Dalits or minority communities. This is the migration from where they have come, the states, and it covers just about everything. And since these are almost 9-year-old maps, in the recent times, we have a lot of migration from Bangladesh, Nepal, and most of them say we have come from West Bengal. Their traditional occupations, makadwalas, service industry, fishing, pottery, laundry facilities, domestic workers, leather, textile, zari workers. I have had many conversations with, most of the zari workers actually employ little kids, just like carpet making, because they have nimble fingers, and those nimble fingers are used to make the embroidery, zari embroidery. And when you go out and tell them that what you're making here, for pinner, pittance of money, is sold in very fancy stores in America for thousands and thousands of dollars. And that kind of advocacy and information being given to them actually helps them. It really makes them understand their own value in the system. I'm going to tell you another story of how mapping actually helped communities to bring tweak the policy and bring the services. So this is an area, this is South Mumbai, this is on the eastern waterfront of Mumbai. This is the wharf, which is called Kaula Bandar. This is a 60-year-old slum. I talked about it, about related to fire. So it's surrounded by water, three sides, connected to land only on one side. We worked here for 5 long years on various issues related to slum health. This is the community, and I'm going to zip through this very quickly to see, make you understand the densities of these areas. Dark lanes, you can barely walk through a lane in a single file. Both of those are my colleagues. This is Sabira doing self-enumeration. Sabira lives in the slum. These were the maps we created. So this is a map of percent of household that purchases water, and you can see almost everybody has to purchase water there, drinking water. This is not even other water. And people spend anywhere from 18 to about 32% of their monthly income just purchasing water, depending upon the season. So in summertime, it's close to 30, 35%. In winter time, it is much less. Children who are unimmunized or under-immunized, and again, majority of them are actually not immunized. So actually the average showed 29% of children in Kalabandar were only immunized, while the entire recognized slum, so by the way, I forgot to mention, this slum is sitting on a Bombay Port Trust land, which is a federal land. Therefore, we don't have a policy for them. So anybody sitting on a federal land, there is no policy in India for them. Therefore, they don't exist as far as the federal people or federal government is concerned. So when we figured out that this was only 29% immunization rate, then we decided, but where is the rest of the health things? So we mapped the health posts, dispensaries where immunization can happen to children. All of these are more than 2.5 kilometers from where people live. And then we helped mapped the health posts. Again, all of them are further away from where people live. We took this data, these three maps, and our enumeration data to the health commissioner, Mrs. Manisha Maiskar in Mumbai. So first of all, she said, oh, but where is this? It's not in my map. So she actually came to figure out whether we actually existed or we didn't. And once she knew that, then she said, okay, what do you need? And we said, we need health camps coming to the community directly, bringing health services at the doorsteps of the community, which she agreed to. She tweaked the policy because actually she's not supposed to enter a federal land which is not owned by BMC. But she tweaked the policy. I admire that lady for that. And from that time onwards, the community gets health camps twice a month. Meanwhile, for 18 months in a row, we did door-to-door education of every single woman who was a mother in that community with pictorials, educating them about what are the four important diseases against which their child needs to be immunized, and if they don't immunize it, what will happen to that child? This literally was done by our team, the barefoot researchers who live in the community, who were trained in all of this. We trained them. 18 months of door-to-door education with the help of pictorials, maps placed everywhere in the community, and the health camps coming twice a month. At the end of 18 months, we repeated the survey, and we had taken the immunization rate to 90.5%. And we were very pleased to take this data back to Mrs. Maiskar. So this is, then of course we did some other mapping. Now look at this. Number of toilet seats, 19. Functioning toilets, 8. We took this map and this data to Milind Deora, who is the local member of parliament. We showed it to him. Then he decided to build some more toilets for the community. So things like that can happen. These are very great evidences to show to the policymakers. This is Bali, my colleague, who actually lives in Kalabandar. And these are all these kids. And there are 11 of them in this area. This is, of course, 2011. They live there, they work there, they eat there, they sleep there. They all are bonded laborers. Interesting. So this is the area of Kalabandar. All these green areas are the service and repair areas. This is a land leased by the Bombay Port Trust to various industries for collecting taxes from them. But these people, residential areas, who live, either work here or work around in the port, they don't exist. As far as Bombay Trust is concerned, you don't exist here. Look at the governance side of it. Police station outside the slum. Ration shop, only one. And this is 15,000 plus community. This is another ration shop which never functions and never open. Only this one functions. And this is the police station. So if there is any problem here, everybody has to get to here. No sanitation. This is what Kalabandar looks like. Oh, we did biometric study. We did, you know, height, weight. But most of all, we coded every single house and gave them an address. And these are the homes we did biometric on, about 7,000 samples. This is, again, our team doing biometric in the slum. I think I'm going to skip this slide. This is Kajol, who lives in the Kaula Bandar, and this is her talk about what mapping has done to her, but I'm not too sure if I have the time to go through her video.
आपने जो कोला बंदर में मैपिंग किया उसमें क्या सीखने मिला आपको?
कोला बंदर में जो मैपिंग किया उससे ये सीखने मिला मुझे कि पहले मुझे मेरा घर कहाँ है उतना ही एरिया पता था कोला बंदर का, लेकिन मुझे मैपिंग के जरिए ये पता चला कि आगे कोला बंदर कितना बड़ा है, 12,000 कुछ लोग रहते हैं वहाँ पे, और गली कितनी है, गलियों में छोटे छोटे घर कितने हैं, कहाँ तक पानी पहुँच रहा है, कहाँ तक लाइट पहुँच रहा है, और 12,000 लोग रह रहे हैं तो वहाँ पे टॉयलेट कितने हैं, वहाँ पे सिर्फ दो ही टॉयलेट हैं यूज करने के।
This is a map of Mandala in MS Ward. This is our master map created by barefoot researchers who live there. That's Sakira doing enumeration. We did this water distribution. The green spots are where high functioning or normal functioning water taps, and the red spots are all non-functioning water taps. That's Tejal, my colleague, doing mapping. These are again the water tap maps. We took all these maps of water holes to Pani Hak Samiti in Mumbai, which is actually helping the BMC to execute the High Court order that every single slum dweller in Mumbai, legal, illegal, doesn't matter, should get 50 liters per head per day of water. After 3 years of giving the order, nobody has ever implemented actually that order. So Paniyak Samiti started this work in Mandala with the help of these maps. So again, after all the struggle they have had with municipal corporation, just about 6 months ago, they have started building the water infrastructure in Mandala. I think I have already talked to you about success stories of Kaula Bandar and Mandala. I don't have the map with me, but we are also working in Palghar in the tribal district, where we are working on digital literacy. And our barefoot researchers, whom we call barefoot researchers here, they have become e-sevaks there because they deal with e-governance and governance systems, educate people, villagers, about their rights to governance issues. Every one of those villages, and we are working currently now in 17 villages, every one of that village was mapped by our e-sevaks, which are locally trained youth within each village. And in each village, we had about 10 to 12 youth, a team of youth, who works with the local people. What they did is they took the map of their villages to the panchayat. So they knew where is the water source, where is school, where is not health, everything. And because their knowledge of their village was so fantastic, that the Gram Panchayat members, most of the Gram Panchayat members in many villages would actually invite these e-sevaks and take their help to disburse the funds that village receives on 14th Finance Commission. So that is how the policy makers actually take help of the maps to come up with policies that are going to help the people. Another story, this story is very interesting. So in Cuttack, one of our sister concerns actually were mapping the city. Cuttack Municipal Corruption was mapping the city, and they omitted 77 communities, which are slum communities, in their mapping. So our sister concern, the Mahila Mandal people and Spark went out there, mapped all the 77 communities and presented it to the Cuttack Municipal Corporation, and that actually enabled every single person living in that community to access Rajiv Gandhi Awas Yojana. So these are the few examples that I have given to you, which tell you how much mapping helps communities, marginalized communities, to access services, to access the special entitlement that they are actually entitled to, and helps them negotiate better. Now we have to discuss how democratized is actually open street maps and all the other sites. And for majority of the part, I think they're truly democratized. But I was having this big discussion with Arun about this process of democratizing. And I'm sure you all have realized that while these sites are truly democratized to a very large degree, they are still not accessible to people who can't speak English, who don't have access to internet, and who cannot actually work on an internet. But because in Palghar village, I have seen many, many youth have smartphones. It's not that they don't have it, but they don't use it for anything else except watching videos on YouTube. They don't know how to work with a mapping system because they don't have the knowledge. So how do we all change this is a question I want to leave with all of you. Because if you really want to say that we have a system which is truly democratic, then we need to figure out a way of making open street mapping and Mapillary and Smithsonian and IDFC institutes available to 60% of the people globally, 1 billion of them, who live in slums and who could utilize the technology that you guys have created or working with. So how do we do that? And the only way this can be done is to create a partnership between people, public, and private. It is Janata, Bazaar, and Sarkar, to borrow from Rohini Nilakani. She talks about this all the time. So if OpenStreetMap forms a partnership with, say, PUKAR or a Yuva or a Koro, and then together we go to Bangalore municipality or to Mumbai municipality and to say, listen, we really want to do this slum mapping so that you have better understanding of what their needs are, they might think to fund us, because at the end of the day, nobody has as much funds as the governments have. And it's the money that we all pay taxes into, right? So it's really not their money, it's our money. So we have every right to ask for it. But to be able to get that kind of a help, we truly need to create those kind of collaborations and partnerships where we can then say we have actually democratized this technology to the last woman in that slum. And that is something I would like you to think about and leave with, and hopefully over the next 2 days while I'm here, I'm hoping that I would have the chance to have a conversations with few of you or many of you and see if we can come up with such kind of avenues where we all will feel we have truly democratized it. My last map is a mental map done by a Varli artist of his village. So thank you very much for your time and your attention. Done? Okay.
Would you like to take questions?
Sure, I'll be happy to.
Okay, great.
Yep.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anita. It's an honor to have you here, and the stories are amazing. I'm quite glad to see all the maps, and she'll be here throughout the conference, so please find her, have conversations. We'll probably take two questions, if anybody has questions. Otherwise
we move.
Yes. Show of hands.
Hello. Hi. How big a problem is navigation in spaces which are like crowded and cramped, as you showed, lanes do not have enough space. When you have volunteers who are not from that area, do they rely on people who know the way?
No, but we don't take volunteers which are not from that area. Okay. Our fundamental ethos is where we map, we train a local youth right there. Yeah. There's no outsider coming there.
It's the proverbial patli gali, right? Like, you have to know it to be able to go through it.
Yeah, but I think that's what the first thing when we go into a newer community, that's what we do. We create a team of local youth and we actually traverse the entire community, even for them to understand what their community looks like. Like Kajal said, you know, she herself did not know what Kolamandir looked like beside the lane she was living. But once they started mapping, it also, you know, some funny things happened. So when we started mapping in Kolamandir, they all carried the GPS little instrument. So people will say, oh, but what's that? Is that a phone? Is that a camera? How does that work? That kind of curiosity coming from people also helps them to understand. And then when you have to ultimately take these maps to the corporator, if you tell the people, okay, let's go together, they all are very willing to come because you have already created an equation with them through your machines and through your interactions. Yes, go ahead.
You have provided address for every doorstep in Dawei, and it's amazing to know that. So, did they get Aadhaar? Definitely. And how did you come up with a scheme to give them an address and an identity?
So, actually, we created a methodology called coding. We worked on that methodology for quite some time. We piloted it out. It was very successful. Because see, if you're doing research in a community, if I'm doing research on a community with on blood pressure or on diabetes, I should be able to locate that house back again to find out my patient. How am I going to do that if I don't have an address? So we had to create a coding system. The coding system, the paper that we wrote on that coding system, by the way, we have about 9 papers in international peer-reviewed journals based on our various projects. That paper was read by somebody at National Institute of Health in Washington, D.C., and they actually invited us to present that entire system. Now, did they get Aadhaar card? The answer is no, because you still need a legal address that BMC accepts. But did they get voters' cards? Yes. And of course, this is a classically vote bank strategy. Whether you have a tenure or no tenure, but I want you to vote for me. So here is the voter's ID. And once they get the voter's ID, then their possibility of getting a tenure address also becomes a little better. So no, they did not get Aadhaar card.
I have a quick...
Go ahead, Arun.
So it's fantastic to see these stories on how the maps have empowered marginalized community. There's also an alternate concern by some folks that the maps of such communities can be misused against them. For instance, like real estate lobby coming and figuring out, oh, this is where you can take over. You think these concerns are valid, and how does one navigate around that?
Actually, these concerns are very valid. And the people who mostly misuse these maps, and that has happened, are developers. So all the slums in Mumbai, which are on the eastern waterfront, we mapped a lot of them. You know, somebody will come into the community, somebody, I'm this community leader, somebody gives me 5,000 rupees and says, oh, map de do mujhe. It's very easy to do that. How do we navigate that? It's by educating people not to give this information to people who may actually bulldoze them out. And it requires a large amount of advocacy, which is labor intensive and time consuming. And that's the advantage of having training of the local youth. Because I may not be able to get to everybody living in Kolamandir because they go to work in the morning and they come back late night and they don't get a single holiday. I'm sure you know that people who work in informal settlements get no weekly off. But I can tell Bali, Nizam, and Kajol, bhaiya, usko jaake na raat ko 11 baje pakdo.
And we have done that. Over the years, we have developed this, that most of our barefoot researchers will go and approach people at night or first thing in the morning when they are available. That is the beauty of the model we have created. And education, education, and education is what we actually need to tell people, that no, be careful with whom you are giving this information. Many a times, they will not give it to me because they cannot relate to me, but they will give it to Nizam because Nizam lives next door. So that's how it actually has worked for us. Yes.
Good morning, ma'am. Have you ever used satellite data for mapping the urbanization rather than mapping manually?
So actually, a lot of times we take the satellite images and then add the layer of on-the-ground mapping. One of my colleagues, P.K. Das, actually did the entire mapping of slums in Mumbai. The problem with satellite mapping images are twofold. Number one, a lot of those images are not that clear. So anything that is sort of a single story, they'll take it at a slum. So there is no real distinction between what is actually a slum and what is not a slum. And second thing is, a lot of times those signals don't work. If you can look at the densities, many a times even our GPS instruments may not work because it is too dense for the signals to actually work. So those technologies need to be refurbished or refined to get clarity. So, but ideally it should be the satellite imagery overmapped with the local GPS. That's the most ideal situation.
Hi, good morning.
Yes.
Okay. Here, sorry.
Yeah.
So thanks for sharing the great stories behind the Mumbai suburban, like our backward classes. What I want to really understand is, like, you collected a lot of information related to backward classes. Is this information available in OpenStreetMap or is it related with PUKAR itself?
No, all this information is available on PUKAR website, and anybody who wants to take it, you're most welcome to take it. If we cannot share the knowledge, we should not be producing it. Knowledge is not to be hoarded. And I think in this country, there is a long history of knowledge hoarding and keeping majority of the people, keeping Bahujana Samaj illiterate. And we are against it. Just like OpenStreet Mapping is, and just like IIM-B is, that no. If you create the knowledge, you must share it. Otherwise, don't create it. Thank you.